And that was a quick look at the history of the JCPOA. Now, for those of you that have just joined us, our top story is, of course, the withdrawal of the United States from the Iran nuclear deal and the ramifications that it may have. Now, in order to discuss that more, we are joined by Alexander Azadgan, professor and editor-at-large at imperianews.com from Irvine, joining us live, and also Mike Harris from Veterans Today, joining us live from Phoenix. Thank you very much for joining us. Now, we've discussed Trump's move, and we've tried to shed light on the different angles of the ramifications that it may have. But now let's go back to President Hassan Rouhani and his speech after President Trump's announcement. First of all, Mr. Rouhani said that he was expecting that to happen, and he has taken necessary measures to counter what Donald Trump called, of course, the highest level of economic sanctions. Mr. Azadegan, what do you think these measures could be? In what way is Mr. Rouhani prepared? How can Iran be prepared for these measures?
Hanged up and I'm on hold, yep. So I don't know what time is actually going on. Yeah.
Thank you, Gisu, for your invitation. It's always good to be with Press TV, perhaps the last bastion of free speech and truth. The Iranians, I'm sure, have prepared for this scenario even before the election of Mr. Trump. When I was in Iran a year ago on an academic mission, I lectured in front of top Iranian think tanks, and I realized their level of contingency plan and backup plans was quite professional and well prepared. Rest assured, this discussion about the nuclear weapons or nuclear energy, this is all a red herring. It's all a distraction effort from what they really wanted to do, which is the entire collapse of the economy, Iranian economy. In fact, a declaration of war on Iran's economy, which would lead to a regime change in Iran. That was their goal right from the outset. Mr. Obama hinted to that even officially on the sidelines. So did Mr. Kerry. And I think in Mr. Trump, you see the full manifestation of barbarism, bullyism, lack of any diplomacy whatsoever. Your region definitely suffers from a deficit in diplomacy, and there's an overflow of bullying that we are seeing in Mr. Trump and his new cadre of advisors, including John Bolton and now Mr. Pompeo as the Secretary of State. Keep in mind, with the case of Mr. Bolton, he openly advocated regime change in front of the most brutal terrorists in Paris, known as Mujahideen Khalq organization. So there's no second guessing. They have made their agenda quite apparent to everybody, and everybody knows, experts and diplomats know that Iran has abided. In fact, 19 times the IAEA confirmed full cooperation of the Iranians. So all that we are seeing in the media is nothing but psychological warfare and an effort to manufacture consent for yet another war. This is the same president that looked into the eyes of Hillary Clinton, Secretary Hillary Clinton, and said you and Mr. Obama supported the ISIS, created ISIS, and which cost the United States $6 trillion. Well, in fact, Mr. Trump is pursuing the same strategy. He is deprioritizing America's needs and wants and strategic goals and objective by once again involving a certain regime that is has borders with the Mediterranean Sea, a regime that has at least 350 to 400 nuclear warheads, which never signed the NPT, which never had IAEA inspections, and that regime, in addition to a certain regime south of the Persian Gulf, are trying to use America's prestige or whatever is left of it to create their own proxy war, this time involving United States, and using a bully like Mr. Trump to get even more involved in this whole region that has become a meat grinder to the local population. This is a serious, serious matter. When you go to a certain country south of the Persian Gulf and sell them $350 billion in a period of 10 years, those weapons are not going to be sitting in their deserts like toys. They would want to use it at some point. When you have a regime that is bordering the Mediterranean,
who has been bombarding Syrian positions, including where Iranian specialists may be located. This is already war. All wars start economically, then they go into full physical war. This is what we are trying to make sure the populations of the world that are hearing our voice on Press TV become awake, alert, and aware. This is what this is all about. It's a media war, and it's a bombardment of the Iranian economy in the months to come. And I hate to be the bringer of bad news, but the next few months are going to be quite difficult for Iran until Iran sees its European partners hopefully take this opportunity to pursue a separate foreign policy than what they have been doing during the past 70 or 80 years. We are seeing signs of that in Germany. The laying down of the Nord Stream pipeline between Vyborg, Russia, and Greifswald, Germany, is an indication that the Germans want to pursue their own foreign policy, especially when it comes to Russia and, in fact, in the entire European continent. The fact that the German chancellor is being looked upon as the leader of the so-called free world, and for the first time that position is not being given to an American president, gives us some indication that Iran's European partners may want to somehow diverge from what Washington dictates at them. And of course, Germany is perhaps the most important signatory of JCPOA when it comes to the European continent. Let's also not forget that people in North Korea and DPRK are closely monitoring this reneging that Mr. Trump's administration is implementing. When they talk about the denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula, they are in fact talking about the denuclearization of Washington in South Korea, those 15 nuclear bombs that Washington has over there. Sanctions have a generational cause. They turn people into survivalists. They destroy a culture, and this is exactly what Washington and some of her allies are trying to implement in Iran. And by her allies, I'm talking about those two regimes in the Middle East. Let's not forget that every time Mr. Trump uses the word regime or uses the term nuclear deal, this in fact is a neurolingual programming. This is not a nuclear deal. This is the language that Mr. Trump is used to as a real estate broker. This is a nuclear agreement between six superpowers. I'm sure the people in Iran who were celebrating in August and July 14th to be exact, of 2015, are looking at this whole thing again. I am sure the heroic flexibility term that the Iranians introduced into their vocabulary has worked on the Iranian people who were perhaps too euphoric towards JCPOA. However, we should not take the impact of the economic collapse that they're bringing to the Iranian currency, the rial, which has surpassed 70,000 rials or 7,000 tomans to $1. This is war. They are taking Azov, even though Iran fully implemented every which way. I believe the news that we heard today about the enrichment of uranium at the industrial level would send a message to Washington. I believe the defense of your country should be the most important thing. Then comes the economy. I was always against this line of rhetoric that what good does it do if the centrifuges spin and the economy collapses? On the other hand, in reality, those of us who are experts in geopolitics and geoeconomics know that the defense of a nation, no matter how it comes, and of course, Iran never wanted a nuclear weapon, but now they're trying to introduce this negotiation or further dealing, France is on top of this, in order to get the Iranians to give up their domestic production of missiles, which, by the way, the IRGC just limited, not too long ago, limited the range of that because the president of a certain regime bordering the Mediterranean was in fact scaring the European masses that Iran may attack them, which is ludicrous. Iran is a trading partner with Germany, with France, with Italy, definitely Italy, and there is absolutely no danger whatsoever to Europe. I think that certain regime bordering the Mediterranean Sea is trying to eliminate one enemy after the other. Yesterday's announcement that Hezbollah won plenty of seats in the Lebanese parliament also confirms to us that the Lebanese people, not just the Hezbollah faction, is on the side of the resistance and perhaps supporting Iran. the fact that Washington, her allies, her NATO allies, have lost in Syria, the fact that they accused Syria of chemical attacks, which is a complete farce, shows the desperation of Washington. All in all, Washington is losing, has been losing his clout, and I think this is good for the peace and stability of the region, because we have a belligerent person who thinks deals can be renegotiated over and over again. And this is from an international law perspective, this is actually ludicrous. Keep in mind, all of this rhetoric is for the use of the hypnotized masses in the West in order to trigger fear and anxiety. Nobody in the right mind in the European governance system or the economic sector or even the military sector believes any of these things, any of this propaganda that's coming out of Washington. Nobody really has read the 159 pages of the JCPOA outside of us who are experts and the diplomats. I strongly urge anyone who's listening to my voice to go to the internet. They can download the entire 159 pages in PDF to realize how Washington is so blatantly is asking for trouble in the region. They are taking the world, in fact, to the edge of World War III. Anyone who's familiar with my work knows that I'm not an alarmist. What we are really concerned about is a rash response from the Israelis, who seem to think they have the entire Washington political power structure when it comes to the Middle East in their pocket, and that in fact, if they believe that the Iranians are going to take the first, make the first move, they will go and make the first move against the Iranian specialist position in Syria. And we have already seen a couple of incidents of that. I think Germany should be more, we should be more focused more
Mr. Azadgan.
Germany, Chancellor Merkel is quietly unhappy with Mr. Trump. Yes.
Mr. Azadgan, I'm very sorry. I'm going to have to cut you off to also talk to Mr. Mike Harris from Veterans today, joining us from Phoenix. Mr. Harris, what is your take on this situation? Iran says that it will remain in the deal to see if the JCPOA will meet its goals without the U.S. How do you think that will play out? Would that be a possibility? Because we've also seen the European signatories of the JCPOA and Russia and China issuing a joint statement asking Washington not to hinder the process. How do you think that will play out? And what will Iran's options be? We've heard, of course, of threats of leaving the NPT altogether.
Well, you know, Iran is at an interesting point right here, and I really disagree with Mr. Trump's position on this of abandoning the JCPOA. I think this was a good start in the right direction. However, there's also an opportunity here. I think Iran needs to really play their cards very carefully, that if they work with the European allies, the other signatories to the JCPOA, there may be a chance to show good faith on the part of Iran, and let's expand the scope of this agreement, and let's denuclearize the entire Middle East. Your other guest, it was spot on that we have the Israeli regime sitting there on somewhere between 400 and 600 nuclear weapons. They're not members of the non-proliferation treaty. They're accountable to no one, and they are the nuclear power of the Middle East. So if we want to bring lasting peace to the area, let's denuclearize Israel, and let's look at this holistically, and let's begin to get rid of the world's nuclear stockpiles. Ronald Reagan had a good start on this. He worked with the former Soviet Union. Both sides signed the START Treaty and ratcheted down and got rid of many, many of their surplus weapons. The same thing can happen here. We have to just let cooler heads prevail and not let the alarmists, and the Israelis are really culpable of this. Their little show and tell that Bibi Netanyahu did last week, saying that they have these stolen documents that Mossad stole from Iran, balderdash. That's a fabrication on their part. But really, we have an opportunity here, and the whole planet has an opportunity here to put unprecedented pressure upon Israel to get them to abandon their nuclear program and get them to decommission their nuclear weapons. That's really the prize here. That is how you say you snatch victory from the jaws of defeat, is by getting Israel to decommission their weapons and get out of the nuclear arms business.
Mr. Harris, thank you very much. Now, going back to Mr. Azadgan, what do you think would be the options that Iran could have if this doesn't work out. We just had word from Mr. Zarif saying that the next move that Iran will make will, of course, depend on how the signatories to the JCPOA will react and what practical measures they will be taking. But basically, what are the options that Iran has?
I know everybody is interested in this question. Out of respect to my parents who have Iranian ethnicity, out of respect to their country, I will obviously not talk about serious ways that Iran can counter this, that information that I'm privy to. I sort of disagree. I'm at divergence with your guest, with veterans today. The denuclearization or monitoring of the Israeli nuclear industry is never going to happen. As long as Washington is behind them, especially Mr. Trump, who in fact is a wholly owned subsidiary of Israel, is never going to let that happen. Certainly the Iranians can bring up that issue, try to negotiate the fact that Israel must join the NPT or have IAEA inspection just for symbolic purposes, but it's never going to happen. Also, I believe the Europeans are talking the right talk right now with Mrs. Mogherini and also the heads of the three sovereign nations, UK, France, and Germany. But I believe ultimately they are going to follow the U.S. example, or for the lack of a better term, the U.S. bullying. Keep in mind that the U.S. GDP, the U.S. economy, is $18.56 trillion, according to the CIA fact book. At the end of the day, the Europeans are not going to sacrifice their multi-trillion dollar historical ties, especially the UK, which is distancing itself from EU and wants to make itself closer to the US. They're not going to make that risk. We can only count on Germany to some extent, which is truly coming out of its guilt trip for the past 80 years and wants to somewhat play a leadership role, not just in Europe, but in the world. We have seen some examples of that with Russia. Ultimately, in my opinion, outside of the non-proliferation of the nuclear weapons and all these red herring issues, what the Europeans are really concerned about are these multi-billion dollar contracts that they want to build with Iran. What happened with JCPOA in July of 2015 and a process of negotiation that took 12 years is that the Europeans are very serious in wanting to make long-term investments in Iran. The Washington and, of course, their regional allies, Israel and Saudi, do not want that because they interpret that as a prolonging of the Islamic Republic of Iran. They're asking for a regime change. And the fact that the Europeans may not invest in Iran and, in fact, create millions of, well, hundreds of thousands of jobs, which would, in fact, solidify the survival of the Islamic Republic of Iran. And let's keep in mind that Iranian revolution will be 40 years old in February 11. And let's keep in mind that May 14, Israel is going to celebrate its 70th year in power in usurping that land. These are all symbolic things. But at the end of the day, Europeans are making long-term decisions to invest in Iran, and Washington and her allies do not want that. They want the exact opposite. They want divestment. They want an isolation of Iran. And as your other guest said, let's hope that this will be an opportunity for the Europeans to diverge from this foreign policy imposition that they have been under for the past 80 years. And I think the Iranians have an opportunity to really be diplomatic. And of course, I believe in what Dr. Zarif is doing. Of course, I disagree with a lot of his rhetoric too. But if they play their cards right, if they do what they did under President Khatami, which was to drive a wedge between Europe and United States, that would in fact be a diplomatic victory. It will take a lot of expertise in doing that. It will take perhaps appealing this decision to international courts in The Hague and elsewhere in Europe. And it's a long process. My concern is with the Iranian economy. When this happens, it's going to quite possibly create havoc within Iran. And we have had an incidence of this not too long ago at the end of December. And this is exactly what those 200 plus anti-Iran Farsi-speaking broadcaster who got $100 million from U.S. Congress during the tenure of President Bush wants to do. This proportion of anti-Iran, and that's exactly what I'm going to call them, they're not expats, they're anti-Iran, broadcasters is something not to be underestimated. They have already started a psychological war on this. These are the people who believe this was actually a good thing, and we need to make sure that is definitely countered, not just through press TV, but through lectures in Iran at the university level in order to practice that heroic flexibility with the Iranian population.
Thank you very much, Mr. Azadgan. Now, let's go back to Mr. Mike Harris from Veterans Today, joining us from Phoenix. Mr. Harris, what do you think some of the options